chair in there.
You can come right.
Yeah, right here, we can.
Keep going this way. Okay?
Anytime you're feeling lonely. So you all know I started the Chadwick Garden at the university in 1967. And it was a big deal for us because Chadwick really inaugurated the organic movement in this region. And organic hadn't appeared. It wasn't an issue until some years after we started the garden. There were no organic sections at any of the markets. There was no farmer's market. And so organic was still to be affirmed. And what interested me after the garden began was why we had to reaffirm organic nature. What happened that organic had been subverted, in effect, and undermined? Why was organic nature undermined? What happened to the integrity of organic nature that it had to be reestablished? And it was largely as a consequence of Earth Day for us that this happened. We had the garden going for about 4 years before Earth Day happened in 1970. So it's as if we had developed a place in which to celebrate Earth Day. And so Earth Day was a big confirmation for us that we were doing something important, because the whole nation on a weekend, April 22nd, 1970, stopped as if in a seizure about the crisis of industrial society and what had happened to organic nature. So it was a big boost to the organic movement, to the environmental movement, and a big affirmation of what we did in the garden at the university. It was in conflict with the sciences at the university. I was teaching at a science college, Crown College, and the signal moment for me was one night at dinner at a colleague's home. An organic chemist, of course, stepped it off with me to the dinner table and said, "Paul, you know the garden has done more to ruin the cause of science on this campus than anything else?" Yeah, what? I mean, it was just the most extraordinary remark to make to me on the way to the dinner table. And I have to say that I've spent a large part of my life ever since then trying to figure out what that guy meant. And it opened up the major sort of research project of my intellectual career. And what it opened was the physicalist-vitalist conflict. And I'm going to go through that to some extent in the second part of my talk to you. The first half hour, I want to talk about the herbal tradition in order to set up an example of what happened as a consequence of the rise of industrial society, namely herbal healthcare. The botanical basis of healthcare was eliminated. It was just given up in favor of the move to synthetic drugs. So I'll sketch out the history of the herbal tradition for you, and we'll get to the point where it suffered the same fate as organic nature in terms of organic food production. So they're allied in a very nice way. And it was really the second career, because I lost my job at the university partly over the garden, because I was teaching at a science college and they thought organic, you know, it meant chemical. Well, chemicals are chemicals. I mean, there's no difference between, let's say, synthesized vitamin C and what you get from an orange. So what were we talking? It was a hippie plot to further embarrass them. That's what it was. That was pretty much their attitude. And so I was fairly stunned by that, namely that there was such a reductionist notion about what was of interest and of importance to people. How could organic nature be shoved into the background to the extent that it was, in favor of the experimental laboratory, where you could, in fact, artificially synthesize anything found in organic nature if you knew the chemical formula, and you could do it from inorganic sources? Now, that's a kind of tough line to absorb, but that's what happened. Once they found out that from inorganic sources they could artificially synthesize anything from organic nature in the laboratory, they didn't need organic nature anymore. So I left the university in 1972 with Paige Smith. And I needed a second career. So it just happened. It was one of those odd progressions that you can't quite figure out in retrospect. There was an herb company here called Famali Herb Company. It no longer exists. And I somehow got in touch with them, and they gave me a job, even though I didn't know anything about herbs. I knew about the herb thyme. That was the only herb I really knew about. And I had a PhD from Harvard, even though it wasn't in botany, and that seemed to be enough for them. And I don't know if they had the intention at the outset, but they put me up for the position of executive director of the Herb Trade Association, which was the trade association for the national industry, which was just beginning to pick up again. And so I had to do a quick read. I mean, I realized that I had to develop a repertoire. I had to learn as much as I could, as quickly as I could, about medicinal herbs to handle this job as far as organizing the national industry. So I thought I'd write a self-instructional manual and learn about 50 medicinal herbs, the main ones, learn their binomials. You know, every plant has a Latin two-part name, genus and species. So that was immensely important to learn the binomials in order to be clear about identifying a plant. So I had to learn binomials. I had to learn their properties. And I had to learn their uses. And I would do this by studying a group of about 50 herbs that I would select and do this self-instructional manual. I decided to call it The Long-Lost Herbal of Cabeza de Vaca, because I was very much interested in the career of Cabeza de Vaca, which, I don't know if you know, means head of the cow. But this was a guy whose name, his name was Alvar Nunez, Cabeza de Vaca. It was a title that had passed down through his family, because a former ancestor, way back, I think ninth century, a Spanish shepherd by the name of El Jaja, I'm not making this up, helped the king of Spain win a decisive battle against the Moors by staking out a remote mountain pass with the head of a cow. And the king's forces went through there, beat the Moors, and the king, to honor the shepherd for his help, gave him a title, you know, knighted him in effect, and the title was Cabeza de Vaca. So it's a famous name that came down through the generations to my Alvar Nunez, who was the ship's treasurer for the expedition under Narvaez, when about three large ships filled with conquistadors came to the shores of Florida, I think on about the second expedition to the New World. And the year was in the 1520s. The expedition foundered. They're almost all killed. Swamps, Indian arrows, plague, whatnot. And there are only four remaining, one of whom is Cabeza de Vaca, and a Moor named Estevanico. And they walk from the coast of Florida to Mexico City. Takes them 8 years. And when they pass through the region of El Paso, Texas, the native Indians say to them, heal our sick or die. We're starving as you are. Heal our sick or you're going to die. So Cabeza de Vaca prays over the sick natives, and they're healed. That's a miracle, according to the tradition and the legends. And so the Indians initiate Cabeza de Vaca into the traditional medicine of their tribe. And then a large number of them, some hundreds of them, accompany him and his companions to Mexico City to provide safe conduct. And so I thought, okay, here's the first white guy that traveled through the Americas and is initiated into native herbal medicine by the Indians in the area of El Paso. I will ask for the blessing of his healing power on me. and my involvement with the herb renaissance, as I called it, the recovery of the botanical basis of healthcare. So a woman from Findhorn had come to visit me. You guys know about Findhorn?
Scotland.
Huh? Yeah, in Scotland. Do you know the name of the garden there? It was comparable to our garden here at the university because the people at Findhorn also practice Rudolf Steiner's biodynamics, which is a special form of food production that Chadwick, to some extent, introduced along with the French intensive system to the university. And so we had a kind of affinity with Findhorn, although we didn't make anything of it. It hadn't really come into popularity at the time we started the garden here, but we were on the same wavelength, except they were way more airy-fairy. You know, there were entities, you know, hiding behind the compost pile, and they grew vegetables like this because, you know, they had a special, you know, etheric fix with things. And so we weren't like that. I mean, after all, it was at a university. So they were amazing New Age garden. Well, she came to visit, I think, because she heard of the garden and me and my involvement with the herbal tradition and so on. And she talked about how at Findhorn, they would ask for guidance. I thought, that's interesting. I never asked for guidance. So I think I will. I'll not only ask for the blessing of Cabeza de Vaca, but I will ask for guidance in my effort to learn about the herbal tradition. And the guidance I want, please, is to be directed to the origins of the herb tradition in ancient Greece. I want to go back to the beginning, at least there. And I, for years, had taught Greek philosophy and Greek culture, so it was an appropriate place to start, I thought, the origins of Western culture. And I want to know who were the first herbalists in order to establish a transmission from who to 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 me. And in doing so, I would overcome the short circuit in the transmission that had occurred a generation before with, say, respect to my father, who practiced medicine for 50 years in Milwaukee. And he knew almost nothing about herbal medicine. It was exclusively prescribing synthetic drugs. Okay, when we talked about it, he said, yeah, I remember grinding digitalis leaf in a mortar and a pestle, you know, because it's the classic heart medicine. Very dangerous to use because it's extremely toxic. And ironically, it's probably the one medicinal herb that no herbalist would use because it's so poisonous. And he seemed to have remembered echinacea. Yeah, but it wasn't clear what it was used for. So there it was. And my father represented the end of the transmission of the botanical basis of healthcare. And in fact, by my time and beginning with his time, there was no course in the subject matter taught at any medical, nursing, pharmacy, or nutrition school in the United States. Gone. Erased. Nor could you probably find a college or a university in the country where even in the body department the subject matter was taught. Gone. So that fascinated me, that the information system should have been so eliminated from any curricula. And so I was going to restore it with myself and overcome the short circuit in the transmission. I love the idea of transmission. I picked it up from my friend Richard Baker Roshi, who is the head of the Zen Center in San Francisco. And I appointed myself as his friend, his Protestant theological witness. Because here was a guy, East Coast Yankee who received the Buddhist transmission. And I was the witness to it. And that fascinated me because it was palpable. You could almost smell it and touch it. The transmission was so manifest. You could call it a spiritual substance that his teacher Suzuki Roshi passed on to him, and I watched him receive it and in his turn manifest it. We have a comparable tradition in the Christian tradition in terms of the laying on of hands when you ordain a priest. And that's a transmission of the spiritual substance of the Christian tradition from one ordained minister to the next. Okay, so that's another example. So I thought, well, there's some spiritual substance to the herbal tradition and I want to get it. So I had an herbal that somebody had given me just at that time. It was a master's thesis that a woman had done at the University of Texas. Medicinal herbs of Texas. I thought, okay, those are, so there's some herbs there that Cabeza de Vaca would have used. So I opened it, and the first herb was yarrow. I thought, yeah, I knew something about, I mean, I heard about yarrow. Chadwick had talked about yarrow. He might have even mentioned the binomial, but I didn't really remember that. So I read about its properties and the fact that it was a styptic. You can apply it topically to bleeding, and it helps coagulate the blood. And its Latin binomial was Achillium millefolium. And I went, oh, wait a minute. Achillea? I mean, is that Achilles? Is this the herb of Achilles? Yeah. And he used it to stop the wounds of his comrades at Troy. Oh, thank you. I couldn't believe it. Right off, number one. The hero of the Trojan War. One of my favorite guys. And it was a big thrill. You know, I have to tell you, I had a horse at the time, and I had a saddle on a sawhorse in my office that I sat on in front of my IBM Selectric typewriter. And that's how I wrote this self-instructional manual. And it was a great ride. Okay, second herb. Second herb was milkwood. Was it milkwood? Milkweed, yeah. I mean milkweed. Artemisia absinthium. Artemisia? Is that the herb of Artemis? The goddess of the woods, the hunt, and the moon? Yes, it is. Well, please. Yeah, you know, it was the ingredient in the notorious French liqueur absinthe, which does not make the heart grow fonder if you really drink a lot of it. It rots your brain because it has a brain stimulant in it. Toulouse-Lautrec was famous for painting the absinthe drinkers in the late stage of their debilitation. But there she was, Artemis, the goddess of the woods. And there was her herb. Number three. Centauri. Now, you had to know something about Greek lore to get that one. Because I knew about Chiron the centaur, the horseman, who of all the centaurs was wise and good. The rest of them were a bunch of really, I mean, they were beasts. And, but Chiron was the one good guy. And lo and behold, here's his herb, number three. And as I read about it, it turns out that he ran an herb school at the foot of Mount Pelion outside of Athens, and a number of the major Greek heroes in their youth were apprenticed to him to learn about herbs, beginning with Achilles. And so I even had a illustration from ancient sources of Achilles being led by his father to Chiron the centaur. So three, okay? And who taught Chiron but Artemis? She was really the first to transmit herbal knowledge, and he was the recipient who then in turn, through his herb school, trained Greek heroes in their youth. And the fourth was Asclepius, the Greek god of healing. You know, the guy with the staff and the snakes on it. And because snakes and their poison are exemplar for poisons in proper doses being medicines. And so Asclepius is milkweed, and that was the fourth one. And he also was apprenticed to Chiron the centaur. So I had it, I mean, as a result of asking for it. It was really a remarkable experience. And then it was fairly easy to track it from there. I could jump to Plato, even though there's nothing explicitly about herbal medicine in Plato. He does have the theme of the pharmakon, which is amazing. You know, the word for pharmacy and pharmaceutical. And the word pharmakon in Greek means charm, remedy, recipe, and scapegoat. what? Yeah. Almost on the notion of poisons are drugs. I mean, it kind of, so the scapegoat is the guy that you put on the sins of the community to carry for you. And in fact, Greece, Athens, had a festival, the sixth day of Thargelia in the Greek calendar, where they took a criminal that they saved out for the purpose and on a ritual procession led him out to the furthermost precincts of the city, where they beat him on his genitals with leeks and murdered him and burned him in order to rid the city of pollution. And it was the festival of the scapegoat, of the pharmakon. And so that's implicit in Plato, because Socrates was born on the sixth day of Thargelion. It was his birthday, and in a way he suffers the fate of the scapegoat, because Athens singles him out to execute him when he was the one that was there to save them. So then you can go to Aristotle. Aristotle was the big kick. I never would have learned this from philosophy, but because I was on this herbal quest, I found out. Aristotle's father was an herbalist. No kidding. Yeah, and he had a kind of herbal pharmacy in Athens, and Aristotle peddled drugs for him. He was the guy that took the, you know, the herbal preparations to the clients. And I thought, well, then that's the key, because in a way, botany is the key to Aristotle's thought, just as mathematics is the key to Plato's thought. And so here, under the influence of his father, Aristotle makes botany a kind of primary science for himself, with a major influence because of the theme of the actualization of potentialities. An acorn to an oak. That's, you know, central to Aristotle's thought. The actualization of potentialities. Nice mouthful. But what a wonderful theme, acorn to oak. And then Aristotle's disciple, his student, was Theophrastus. And he's the major herbalist of the ancient tradition, because he wrote the first major herbal, which then set the pattern for herbal books from then on, which is one of the great, you know, if you're interested in books, I mean, herbals are just, I brought one to show you today, because it's glorious. And so Theophrastus, the student of Aristotle, sets that pattern, and Theophrastus went on the expeditions of Alexander the Great, who is also the student of Aristotle. And so Theophrastus accompanies him and then learns about herbal plants throughout the travels of Alexander. And then you can pick it up through the Middle Ages. Every monastery had an herb garden, so it was a strong component of monasteries in the tradition, and monks, by and large, were skilled in medicinal herbs and used them for the public health of the monastery. And then, of course, one of the great herbalists in the medieval tradition is Hildegard of Bingen, who was just discovered about my time, as far as my doing this. And if I had had, you know, greater talent or wherewithal, I would have also discovered her music, which came in very strongly in, about 30, 40 years ago, because she composed music, and there are, you know, recordings now and women's groups that sing her music. But she was also an herbalist. She got herbal recipes from the Christ, direct. She must have asked for guidance, and she got it. And so her herbal is extant. It's in print. You can get it in English translation. And there was a Swedish company that made a recipe of hers called Swedish Bitters, which became extremely popular as a tonic. So that was Hildegard of Bingen. I was glad that, as well as Artemis, there was another woman in what is usually an exclusively male lineage. So that was good. And if you'd think there was any subject matter that would include women, it would be herbs. Please. So then the great book on herbals from then on, you know, picking it up mostly from the Renaissance, is Agnes Arber. So this is a great classic. And so this was a great help. I read it, so I learned all about the herbals going through the Renaissance up to the modern period. So, and then this is the great, I picked this out as the major text on herbal medicines by a German herbal physician, Rudolf Weiss. And this is my favorite, but there's a lot of them. I mean, in the last 25, 30 years, there have been a whole profusion of herbal books because of the recovery of the herbal tradition. So I had the transmission intact, and I had my self-instructional manual, and I had my repertoire, and I didn't have to, you know, wear call my bluff on my t-shirt. And so it was a great adventure after the organic garden at the university to get involved in the recovery of the botanical basis of healthcare. It's still not recovered. I mean, even though health consumers in this country have turned their attention to medicinal herbs, professional healthcare has yet to open up to it. Little bit. But, you know, I was in the game in the late 70s, and I don't see much progression from then to now. I keep waiting to hear that some medical school in the country has opened up a course in the subject matter, and I don't know anybody that has. There's probably one I haven't heard of. There is a special category under pharmacology, you know, the science of medicinal drugs, called pharmacognosy, which is the science of extracting from medicinal plants the chemical component that can be turned into a drug. So that's still functioning, but has nearly died out as well. And then we had this great course at Harvard. It was rather unique in the country in traditional medicine. Ethnobotany is the name of the field. And the main figure, Richard Schultes, was somebody I got to know because his specialty was psychedelic plants from South America. So one would want to know such a guy. And I was involved with the Leary Group. I was the founding editor of the Psychedelic Review. And let me tell you, that was a lot of fun. And Leary had discussion groups, and Schultes would come. So I got to know him. He was a wonderful figure to know. And he's got a couple of major books on the psychedelic plants of South America. So that was my herbal trip. And anybody want to comment on that or ask anything about that before we go into the second phase?
You said his name is Richard Schultes?
Yeah, S-C-H-U-L-T-E-S.
Isn't there somebody named Sasha Schultes?
Who?
Sasha Schultes? Is he a Berkeley guy?
No, this Harvard. Mm-hmm. Harvard School of... he was really a remarkably nice man.
What herb did he take to make him so nice?
Oh, yeah, really. He took them all. He was famous for that. He when he went down to South America for his PhD thesis, then nobody saw him, I think, for about 7 years. Yeah.
So I believe
the
those were the mean
second
people.
Herb you were speaking of was wormwood. We said milkwood. But for
that was Asclepius. Yeah, wormwood is Artemisia. Yeah. Yeah.
Right. And that's what's in Epsom.
Yeah, yeah. But it was said as milkwood. I just wanted to make that. Yeah. It occurred to me right after you started talking, you said Artemisia, and then I was like, oh, wormwood. So
that's wormwood. And then there's, what's the other Artemisia? There's a twin, wormwood and...
Mugwort.
Mugwort, right. And absinthe is back. You know, they outlawed absinthe because of its terrible effect on people who became addicted to it. So it was outlawed internationally, and now they've lifted the ban, and you can get it again. There's a wonderful cocktail called Sazerac. I think maybe they use absinthe in that. Anyhow.
Yeah. In your experience and in your academic experience, how does it, the wisdom and knowledge of indigenous cultures, indigenous medicine, come out to play? And especially pre-Greek culture, because a lot of their knowledge and understanding even came from Egyptian culture, with Egyptian alchemy and so forth.
Yeah, I don't have any herbal lore from Egypt. It's all indigenous to Greece, from what I know. They took geometry, you know, and some of that from the Egyptians. There's a funny kind of divide that I consider to be the case from Greece to Egypt, as there is from Israel to Egypt. Egypt is a, you know, the symbol of institutional bondage. And so you want to make the exodus from Egypt in order to get away from their gods and their pharaohs and that whole schmear. So I have a kind of a prejudice against Egypt, you know, in the sense that it's what you want to get away from. And that it's comparable with the Greeks. I gave a talk on Homer downtown one time, and I started off by saying, what would we do without Homer? We'd slide back into Egypt. And the Homeric gods are such a point of departure from the Egyptian divinities that it's a kind of enlightenment. So anyhow, that's an issue in itself. Ethnobotany at Harvard is the place. And so that's where one would go to learn the native medicine of indigenous peoples. You know, and it's so it's disregarded everywhere else. You know, look at the American Indian lore. There's any number of books on that. It's been, I think, fairly effectively recovered in terms of what can be known. So that's available in the literature. And it was amazing how in the Renaissance, when the New World opened up, exemplified by Cabeza de Vaca, plant hunters went out throughout the world to look for plants. And they were brought back to botanic gardens that sprung up as part of the Renaissance, as part of the European Renaissance. It's a wonderful feature of the Renaissance that almost every major city in Europe developed a botanic garden. So you have a kind of jump from the monastic garden to the civic botanic garden. And the first one was Padua. I brought the book, 1545. It's one of my favorites. There's a dispute. Pisa says, nah, we did it first. Ah, well, okay. Anyhow, I'll bet on Padua. And so from Padua throughout Europe, botanic gardens were the thing that a city had to have. It was almost a way of giving expression to the Renaissance, that it's the rebirth of European culture, and where better to celebrate it than a garden, and a great garden. And the botanic gardens of Europe are really, if I could fund this group on a trip to Europe to visit botanic gardens, it'd be one of the greatest experiences of your life. I got to go some years ago and made a tour of French botanic gardens. I mean, they are just like going to some other place. Yeah, I mean, transcendental place. You can't believe it. And some of them are gone, and a number of them have been preserved. Vaux le Vicomte is one of the great botanic gardens in France, outside of Paris, but it take a kind of a fairly brief train ride. And that was developed during the time of Louis XIV, and the guy that did it was the treasurer of France at the time, and he developed this great botanic garden, and when we had it ready, he invited Louis to come, and in a great celebration, he gave the garden to Louis, and Louis went, no, man, you mean you don't give me anything. Are you out of your mind? You're going to jail for this. So Louis just put him in jail for the rest of his life, for the arrogance of, and then where the hell did you get all the money to do this? You take it out of the treasury? So you really deserve to go to jail. And he was known as the man in the iron mask. And it was a scandal of French justice that Louis just, rest of your life. And so then what did Louis do? He dug up half the trees at Vaux-le-Vicomte and brought them to Paris and developed Versailles times 10. And Vaux-le-Vicomte is just, you know, the scale, and it's so fabulous because of that. And Versailles, oh, Louis, I mean, you know, you should have gone to jail. It's just so amazing. So anyhow, that's the way the French did it. And you have, you know, a system of botanic gardens in England and in Italy. One of my favorite examples is Lisbon, Portugal, where after the famous Lisbon earthquake, which shook the shit out of Europe. I mean, it happened on All Souls Day, November 1st, which in Europe is one of the great religious festivals. And they had a major earthquake in Lisbon, and thousands were killed, and they went, wait a minute, what's God doing to us here? Well, as a consequence, they made Lisbon into a garden city, and they have these great garden boulevards that are just fabulous. And the irony is that Voltaire wrote a spoof on Leibniz's notion that this is the best of all possible worlds. And so Voltaire wrote Candide and says, well, then let's have a garden. Let's celebrate this best of all possible worlds in a garden. And it was his answer to the Lisbon earthquake. And in fact, then they did it. They turned Lisbon into a garden. So that's an amazing complex of ideas there. Okay? So, medicinal herbs set the stage for undermining the integrity of organic nature. I mean, what seems better to have been sacrificed in that process than the botanical basis of healthcare? If you're going to go to synthetic drugs and exclusively develop them in the experimental laboratory of modern science, okay, forget the plants. Yeah. You identify the active constituent of an herbal plant, like digitalis, and you take those chemicals that are so identified and extracted, and you artificially synthesize them from inorganic means, which means you can patent it and control the economics of it, and you get the drugs then that are basic for heart disease. And that's what happened. So the same thing happened in terms of the industrial production of food. It occurred in what I call a world above the given world of nature, which is the industrial farm, and it's predicated on synthetic fertilizers and pesticides and machinery, and we know what the consequences of that have been. And so when I tried to figure out why this guy should have said that to me, that the garden would ruin it, I finally found, oh, I get it. He thinks organic is defined by what's artificial and synthetic. How can anybody be so dumb? I remember talking to a chemist once, and he says, well, excuse me, but artificial doesn't mean artificial, and synthetic doesn't mean synthetic. I said, well, what does it mean? Well, he meant it didn't mean what I thought it meant. He meant it was what he thought it meant. Namely, they were technical terms for chemical reaction. Didn't have anything to do with anything else. Oh, God. Okay. So here's the quote on that kind of mentality. It's my best. I'm actually haunted by it. And it's by one of the foremost scientists of the 19th century. For the chemistry of the human organism is fundamentally identical to that of the factory in the laboratory. I mean, it's almost like I get a kind of psychic blow with a 2x4 when I think of that or repeat it. Like, how can anybody be so dumb? How can you compare the chemistry of a human being to a factory and a laboratory? Oh, and what's the chemistry of that? That's buildings. Oh, I get it. That's when they started calling plants factories. Where are you going today, honey? Oh, down to the plant. And that actually happened historically about the time that this all turned around. They started calling factories plants. Why? Because they manufacture chemicals on a big scale like plants do on a little scale. So they're both factories. It's all the scale. Ay, ay, ay. Well, you know, how do you turn that around when somebody really takes on that mentality? And what a mentality it is. Oh, my God. And I've spent 50 years tracking it. So let me tell you. As I mentioned, it's what I call a physicalist-vitalist conflict. That's in the literature. That's what I stumbled upon. What's physicalism? Well, that's the one, that's the game that won. And well, what is it? Well, it actually goes back to Galileo and the significance of mathematical physics as what counts for knowledge. That counts. What you do doesn't count, let me tell you. And so mathematical physics becomes the primary science from Galileo on. And then to add organic chemistry to that in the 19th century, you've got the whole thing as determining what counts for knowledge. Those are the two basic ones as far as I'm concerned. And what happened is that you get a mentality that starts to work on the ideology of this. It's almost a conspiracy. It doesn't bother me at all to call it a conspiracy. I shouldn't even say almost. It's a flat-out conspiracy. The key date that I found is 1828. That's construed to be the origins of organic chemistry. When a German chemist named Friedrich Wöhler, W-O-E-H-L-E-R, artificially synthesized urea. So it was one of the first efforts at artificial synthesis. And what he did is he took ammonium cyanate, which you could get from inorganic sources, heated up to 100 degrees centigrade, and he got urea. When he said urea, I found it. And urea is the nitrogen waste of your urine. So guess what it became? Synthetic urea. And guess what that is? Artificial fertilizer! I mean, can you believe it? The initial experiment that leads to the subversion, the undermining of the integrity of organic nature should lead to artificial fertilizers. And what else, folks? Just to add insult to injury, plastics, polyurethane. So you got synthetic fertilizer and plastics coming off the same experiment. Thank you very much, Professor Wöhler. As in, woe is Mueller. Oh, man. So that was it. I mean, I had the experiment, and that experiment is credited with the refutation of vitalism. What's vitalism? It's the argument for the integrity of organic nature. You couldn't make it anymore. If we could get urea without a kidney from inorganic sources, and then anything else you want to get, just go after it. You don't need organic nature anymore. There's nothing unique about organic nature. What's this vital force bullshit? Or life force, you know, forget Star Wars. So the vital force, that was the kind of term they used to talk about life, when something's alive, you know, when you kill it, the life force is gone. Well, that's all he wanted to do was kill it and say, ha ha, your life force is gone. And you really have a obvious move from life to death. You know why? Because from organic nature, the whole tendency and trend was to reduce everything to matter. Dead matter. And that's all that matters. No kidding. It took me a long time. I'm kind of surprised looking back on reviewing this whole process. I don't know, it probably took me 10 years to finally just focus on matter. I mean, is that what they were after? Going down to matter? And that matter's all that matters? And then atoms in the matter? And the molecules? And that's it? Yeah. And don't give us anything else. That's the real weird corollary to what they did. They said, this is all that matters, and don't talk about anything else, because it doesn't matter. Well, why did you have to go on to say that? Even Galileo, way back, says that. Mathematical physics, the mathematical inquiry into what we want to know, that's all that matters. If it can't be mathematized, forget about it. So shortly after the synthesis of urea, they formed a group in Germany, in Berlin, called the Physicalist Society. You know, as if to say they all of a sudden woke up to the fact that they had it. They refuted vitalism. They don't have to have people standing around saying, well, you know, is there some ethical implication here for the integrity of organic nature? You guys are, no, get out of here. No. Get rid of all the vitalists. Yeah? We got it by the balls, and that's matter, and that's all that matters. So they formed the Physicalist Society to promote that view, and they were the foremost guys of the time. The kind of lead guy was Müller, and under him were Helmholtz, Hermann von Helmholtz, one of the greatest scientists of the 19th century, the guy that formulated the law of the conservation of energy, and on and on and on. Very famous. He was right in there. And Brucke. The next guy, he was the teacher of Freud when Freud was in the experimental laboratory before he became a psychoanalyst, and another guy named Dubois-Raymond. And together they formed and formulated a physicalist oath. Now, how physicalists who are only involved with matter should think of an oath, you know, like what the hell does that mean to a physicalist? It's like a contradiction in spirit or terms or whatever with you guys. What could you possibly mean by loyalty to an oath? And I'm told they took it in blood. So you see what I mean by a conspiracy? That's all you need to know. I've never been able to track that down. I saw it referenced once in a book that the physicalist oath was taken in blood. Yeah, that's good. Okay. They certainly acted as though it was. And so, and then the oath read something about not to take into account any forces operating in any entity but the physical or chemical forces or other forces equal in dignity. And the point being, no vital force, no affirmation of life was equal in dignity to a physical chemical force. So help us, Helmholtz. So that was a huge find to get those guys and to see how important and influential they were in beating out all the vitalists, you know, as if it were some brush fire, wherever it was, you know, like just eliminate it. And so the elimination of vitalism became, for me, the big issue as far as the takeover of physicalism. And then the next step is a group of philosophers in Vienna called the logical positivists, who developed the philosophy of physicalism. And they say the only thing that counts for knowledge is experimental laboratory work and mathematical logic. So no aesthetic language, no poetic language, no religious language, and no metaphysical language, my God, counts for. So all those languages are strictly nonsense. And they held the fort for a long period of time in terms of its influence in philosophy. So the whole thing shifted to the natural sciences. Now I'll read you a quote that hammers it so well that I like reading it to you. It's a little long as a paragraph, and I'll leave it here in case you want to peruse it. From the physical sciences, they're spread over the conception of all existence, a point of view whose model entity is pure matter, stripped of all features of life. What at the animistic stage was not even discovered has in the meantime conquered the vision of reality. The tremendously enlarged universe of modern cosmology is conceived as a field of inanimate masses and forces which operate according to the laws of inertia and of quantitative distribution in space. This denuded substratum of all reality could only be arrived at through a progressive expurgation of vital features from the physical record and through the strict abstention from projecting into its image our own felt aliveness. In the process, the ban of anthropomorphism, the ban on anthropomorphism, was extended to zoomorphism as well. You know, so don't project human beings into anything to kind of feel that they're alive. Don't project anything of animal nature either, or of biological nature. What remained is the residue of the reduction toward the properties of mere extension, which submit to measurement and hence to mathematics. These properties alone satisfy the requirements of what is now called exact knowledge. And then all I gotta do is go to the university today to see how the takeover has, what it's accomplished. I went up there Monday to give a talk on the humanities at the Cal College, devoted to the humanities. They didn't really know what I was talking about. I talked about ancient Greece. They were like, what? Where's that? Who are those guys? I mean, it's not. One guy got up to me, came in my face afterward. I mean, I poured my heart out over my whole experience with the humanities and teaching Greek philosophy and the rise of rational self-consciousness from Homer to Plato and yada, yada, yada. And I might even do it as a class in the spring. I'm a little wary about it now. This guy comes up at the end of the class and he looks at me and he says, I'm not interested in anything you said. I'm interested in getting a job and making lots of money. Now, why did he do that to me? That was really cruel. I lost my temper with him and was real ugly. I'm embarrassed about it now. No, I am. And I have to apologize now next Monday if he comes back to the class, because I really blew him out of the room. And I actually was willing to fight with him. I mean, I would have liked to have gotten him and punched the guy right in the mouth. How Socratic is that? Huh? How wonderfully indirect and teasing out the meaning of knowledge and things is that? So he really got my cork. And it was a very sobering experience, because the provost, who's sort of sponsoring me to go back up there after 50 years, Mr. Rip Van Wrinkle, has warned me. I mean, she's been telling me they're not going to get it. You know, you don't know what's happened. Well, so I think she maybe set me up with this guy. No kidding. So my colleague Paige Smith, who was my greatest pal, who resigned in protest when I got kicked out, wrote a book at the end of his life called Killing the Spirit. And that's his indictment of higher education. Because, I mean, in the course of the Monday night thing, a girl raised her hand and said, what do you mean by spiritual? Well, I know the words kind of like, you know, around down there, and maybe you could find it if you're lucky. I mean, it's a very, you know, it's like soul. What do you mean by soul? Oh, God. Yeah, I know what's happened to the words. But it was so interesting to have somebody actually ask, what do you mean by that? And there's a wonderful essay on physicalism by a philosopher that I really like a lot, Eric Vogelin, where he talks about how natural scientists have become eunuchs for the kingdom of science. They've castrated their spiritual balls for the kingdom of science. And that's a telling indictment. Okay. So, anyhow, that was the big eye-opener to kind of hit this physical vitalist conflict and to have it really account for what happened as part of the rise of industrial society as a world above a given world of nature and therefore devoid of vital roots. So what we're dedicated to is the restoration of vital roots, and this program here has been one of the best I've ever been involved in terms of accomplishing that. Thank you very much.
Thank you.
Go Forrest.
I have a question just in view of the audience. Paul, will you just speak like 5 minutes of the founding of the garden and how that came about, and the homeless garden project?
Yeah. First of all, we started the first public shelter in 1985, and we were overloaded almost immediately. So we had to organize churches to take in the overflow to the extent that we could. And we finally had, I think, up to 40 churches countywide taking in some of the overflow one night a week, 7 days a week. Then it was a matter of noticing all these guys, mostly they were males, who were full of beans and active and for the most part, physically very capable. What do we do with them? So we worried about it. We were going to start a conservation corps in Santa Cruz and kind of put them to work on conservation projects because a number of them were willing to do it on a volunteer basis. We didn't have any funds to pay anybody for that kind of effort. And then somebody called me one day and said, we've got $1 million worth of herb plants here. We're shutting down the nursery. Do you want them? And I said, no, I don't know. I don't know what to do with $1 million herb plants. I'll take 1,000 or so, you know, whatever we can get in a truck. And I figured, okay, if I get the plants, we're going to have a garden. I mean, you know, we're going to have to water them and get them in the ground. So it'll force the hand on a homeless garden project. And so we sent a truck down and picked up the plants. And at that time, we put them over where the original garden was at Trescany, right?
Pelton.
At Pelton. Because I knew the bluegrass group there.
Harmony Grits?
Yeah, Harmony Grits. Knew those guys. And they had a great big backyard area. And I said, I got all these plants. And would you help water them until we get a garden site? And they went, sure. So we dumped them all there and they watered them. And then they went to Jim Lang, who's now on the board of the Homeless Garden Project. And he was then head of Parks and Recreation. I said, we want Poganet. So this is 1986. And I had saved Poganet, I don't blush to say. I was the initiator of the Greenbelt effort with a botanic garden at Poganet in mind, the arboretum, the farm, the garden, and Poganet. Come on. Perfectly obvious. It'd be a great civic botanic garden, just like they got in Europe. And so I said, well, I want Poganet. I saved it, so give me a space. No, no, it's too political. I should have hammered him. I mean, he said, I'll show you a space. So we go down to Pelton, across the street from which are the herb plants. He said, here, you can have this. I said, okay. We just have to walk them over. So that's how the garden started. And then they had a real guy, I forget his name, who ran the community garden program. And we had actually started that. Paige Smith and I started the community garden program for the city. And then City Parks and Rec had taken it over. And so that was the site of one of the community gardens adjacent to the space he said we could have. So this guy who was running community gardens said, okay, you have to pay the fee of a community garden to put in your homeless garden project. And no, I don't. I mean, come on. Well, so we paid. It wasn't much, like maybe $50. Well, he thought that gave us about the size of this tabletop, right? I mean, we got one plot. And so we started building more plots, and he wanted more money for each success. And I said, no, no, it's free from here on, pal. So we just did it.
Yeah.
Like you should do here. I mean, don't hesitate, no matter what Derry says. Just extend it as far as you want. Ron Swenson isn't going to say anything.
All right.
Hey, you want to sleep here in your vans? Don't listen at all to what Derry says. You want to sleep in this building here? Go ahead and do it. I give you permission. I'm the founder. Come on, we gotta pick this place up. Yeah, we've been running rear guard action. We're behind the cart, you know, and this is the year we're going to get ahead of the game. And Poganet is the big symbolic expression of that. We're going to have to really kick this budget that we've got up to $1 million, and we're going to do it. So it's a great moment Derry's been holding the show all these years, since 1989. It started a year before they credited it because it was the feminist takeover from me. And they marked that from 1990 on, when I started in 1989. All right, okay. It's my one concession. My one concession to women's lib besides sitting down when I urinate. No, he didn't say that. No, so anyhow, they say 1990, it was 1989, but why should we quibble over that?
Exactly.
Yeah, right.
And Paul, if you'd been a woman, you would have founded the
I wanted group. To be a woman.
Yeah.
So.
It's a nice balance.
Yeah, it's the fate of sexual differentiation. No kidding. I had a wonderful mother. That helped a lot. So that's how it started. And boy, look at the whole pad. A funny moment at the beginning. We had this guy here. It was this insufferable little jerk named Moonbeam.
Moonrise.
Moonrise. He kind of looked like a moonrise. He was about so tall, and he was, you know, like. And I remember him about a year into it. He came up to me and he said, "Why do we need these women running this thing? And they get salaries and we do all the work. We don't get anything. Why can't we have the salaries?"
And what was the answer?
I didn't know what to say. Get the hell out of here. Moonrise.
Rise to the moon.
Yeah, really.
One more time.
Well, come back often this year. I think you'll see a lot happening on the ground this year on the farm.
Yeah.
And
and grow herbs. Should put in a, you know, medicinal herb area.
Yeah.
Just for the heck of it, you know, and you could actually bag it and tea it. You know, you could use them for teas and tisanes and tinctures and so on. You could have a little enterprise like that down here. A lot of other people do it. I wanted to say that I've got a lot of herbal books and botanic books and garden books. So if any of you want to come down to my house at some point, just say so. I mean, figure out a time when you want to come and I'll show them to you. And they're terrific. So I brought Brunfels. This is one of the beauties of my collection. And you know, you only have to handle something like this, and you know, please. So this was a great consequence of being involved with the herb trade, is that some of us got totally enamored of very expensive books. Yeah.
So my two of my things go back to the first part I was supposed to say during the first part.
Yeah.
One is the Hippocratic Oath.
Uh-huh.
Which is, I think it's something like, first of all, do no harm or something like
that. All right, yeah.
How does that fit into your story about the transmission of herbal knowledge? Is that towards the beginning of all of that?
Yeah, yeah.
And was it related to using herbs?
Yeah, exclusively. And some minerals. So it was only herbal mineral products that were used for medicinal purposes up until synthetic drugs.
And so was Hippocrates part of that lineage that you were talking
about? Yeah, and he'd be real early. He'd probably be fairly contemporary to Dioscorides. I don't know if I mentioned his name. He was the next one to do a major herbal after Theophrastus. And his herbal, which was an update a couple hundred years later, then became the standard herbal for the entire tradition, up until the proliferation of herbal books and the development of botany and the opening up of the world and the discovery of all the plants that could be used medically. So he's one of the earliest figures. I should have mentioned Galen. Galen was Roman, and Galen kind of set the pattern for medicine up until Paracelsus. And they're both fun to study. Galen operated on what is reminiscent of a Chinese model. You know, earth, air, fire, and water, hot, cold, dry, moist. You know, the Chinese use that as a diagnostic thing, and that was Galenism as well. And that comes off of pre-Socratic philosophy, when they start thinking about, well, what is it? Well, is it water? That was the first word of pre-Socratic philosophy. Air, that was another word. And then they get into the hot, the cold, the dry, and the moist. You know, condensation and rarefaction. And then that becomes the major pattern for medicine, along with the temperaments, you know, the choleric, the sanguine, yada, yada. There are about four or five temperaments that were considered to be diagnostic procedures. And then Paracelsus comes in the Renaissance. He's called the Luther of medicine. He overthrows the Galen model by virtue of saying, look, don't impose this bullshit on people when you try to diagnose what's wrong. Just look at them. You know, forget the hot, the cold, the dry, the moist. You know, just be empirical about it. And so he dumped the Galen system and revolutionized diagnosis. And he was a great herbalist and also used minerals and so on. And it was a kind of early chemist regarding medicinal products, iatro chemistry it's called, anticipating what finally happened. So Paracelsus is a lot of fun to read about. His name was Theophrastus Bombastus von Hohenheim, and his nickname was Paracelsus, because Celsus was an ancient figure, and para means before Celsus, I am. So that's that.
So will you also talk about your Chadwick book and when it's coming out?
Oh yeah, I just finished the Chadwick book, I'm happy to announce. It's taken me 40 years, not too bad. Mm-hmm. Oh, God. And it's all designed, sealed, and delivered. I needed a picture of the first walk I took with the chancellor to look for a possible site for the garden with my daughter on my shoulders. And I'm walking into Poganup with Eric and happened to mention this. And he says, oh, I was on that walk. I took a picture. And in fact, I knew it was in the yearbook, but I didn't know he had taken it. He said, yeah, I took that. And I've got it cataloged. So I got it. So North Atlantic Books is going to publish it. It'll come out at the end of the year. And so that'll be a nice move. And I... you know, in a way, it's a force fit. I tell the story of the garden, and that's easy and fun for anybody to read because Chadwick was such a dramatic figure. And then I dump in this whole physicalist vitalist conflict, which a lot of people say, well, that's a force fit. Well, you know, you're a philosopher. You think that's interesting. I don't. I'll care. You know, it's my book. Yeah. And I spent 40 years pursuing this. And I maybe should have, you know, done another book with that, but God, you know. One's enough. So anyhow, it's got all that in it.
And it's called The Garden of the Mind?
Yeah, there is a garden of the mind. That was the line from Norman O. Brown, who is the most famous teacher on the campus. He was the New Age guru. He had written a book called Life Against Death, you know, right on the theme, and Love's Body, where he talked about polymorphous perversity. So that really hit a nerve as far as everybody getting high. And so when he came to the university, he was really acclaimed as, you know, the guy. So he took a big interest in the garden, and he wrote a meditation on the garden called My Georgics, following Virgil, who wrote the original Georgics. And so the line comes from that meditation on the garden.
Which is that there's a film of that, which is great.
We did a movie on the garden, and that's the soundtrack for it, and it's fun. Yeah.
Are you familiar with Rupert Sheldrake?
Yeah, sure.
Yeah. Sorry, just
he was a botanist in his initial. Yeah, my ex-brother-in-law is Harrison Ford. If you want to get at it.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Cool. No, I read Rupert Sheldrake's book, Rebirth of Nature.
Yeah.
And I thought that was really interesting. I mean, like, a lot of the physicalists, vitalists.
Right on the line.
You speak, it's right on the line. I mean, talking about sort of morphogenetic resonance.
I was disappointed in the book because he didn't really grab it the way I would have liked to have done it.
Slow to start.
Huh?
It was really slow to start.
Yeah.
Kind of get into it till too late.
I thought, oh, Rupert, you could have done better than that. But that's a, you know, it's on the line. And he's a remarkable figure for all of this. He's a definite vitalist. He's even he calls himself, you know, like a pan-vitalist, where everything's alive instead of everything being dead. He just reversed it again. And it's kind of humorous in being so courageous about it, because he's taken a lot of hits in science. When he published his first book, remember the title?
I don't remember the title of his first book. No. I don't own it.
Yeah, it escapes me. It was reviewed by Nature, which is one of the great science journals, and the editor of the journal reviewed it and said, this is his major candidate for burning, this book. Well, who are you, Hitler? I mean, it was a real dumb thing to say, you know, given the burning of the books by Hitler. But that's how provocative Rupert's line was, and he's really talking about consciousness,
right.
You know, morphic resonance.
Yeah.